Well, good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for joining us for the EDP live Facebook piece we're going to do now. I've got the wonderful Ian Clark next to me,
who's going
to be taking your questions. So any questions you want at all, please make sure you find them as quick as you can. I'm sure there's plenty you want to talk about. There was a bit of a game at the weekend that we all kind of thought was going to be season-defining. I think it's probably thrown up more questions than we thought it was going to do, not just in terms of the performance, but also I think the reactions afterwards, and even listening to Paddy Davitt's quotes on his Twitter feed today from the press conference that's going on at Corney, literally it's just finished. Lots of angry people and angry managers and angry players sort of sitting there now. So in my view on Saturday's game, for me, it was all about going there and not losing. I still felt if they got a draw, something from the game, that there's still an opportunity with 11 games to go to get points to try and push themselves into the playoffs, whether that's to catch Sheffield Wednesday or whether it's to catch Leeds or Reading, whoever it's going to be. I think one of those teams will drop away. But it was important not to go there and not lose. And the worst thing possible to happen would be to get battered. And unfortunately, that is exactly what happened. And it wasn't as if Sheffield Wednesday had to work hard for their five goals either. It was kind of gifted to them on a plate. And listening to Alex Neil's quotes this morning saying that this group of players haven't got the determination, the fight or the desire away from home is pretty damning. I think he's got to the stage now where perhaps he's not protecting his players anymore.
No.
He's kind of saying what he thinks. There's clearly lots of players at that football club that he doesn't want there. I think there's probably a lot of players at that football club that don't want him there. So at the moment, it seems to me if they're stuck between a bit of a rock and a hard place in terms of what to do next for the football club. So get your questions in, if there's anything you want to ask myself or even Clarkie from the press side of it. But it is really, really difficult to try and not draw a line under a result like that. But, you know, you've got three opportunities now in Bristol City, Blackburn, and was it after that one?
One of the lower teams, but after that you've then got Brighton, you've got Huddersfield, you've got Leeds.
Which is why it was so important to get that half-decent result against Sheffield Wednesday to set yourself up to still have that belief, whereas now it's just throwing out more doubts and more toxic atmosphere than there ever has been, I think. And we go right back to when it all kind of, the bad run happened and the manager probably at the time and most other clubs would have been sacked.
Yeah.
They kept hold of him, he turned it around, but you know, hindsight's a wonderful thing, but I did say at the time, once something like that kind of sets in, it does tend to happen again at some point. But clearly, the football club are backing him. They want him as their manager. They want him there for the rest of the season. And whether we're going to see him in next season, I don't know. I think if Norwich don't go up, I think he'll still be here.
The board seem to be saying that he's their man without any timescale. So as long as they stick, you know, to that view... Mm. And they, as I say, they haven't changed their view on it. The ball's not going to change.
I think there's some questions coming in.
Not yet. Can we get those questions in? I mean, just from your time, Darren, obviously, as a pro over many years.
Yep.
I mean, players don't always get on, do they? They don't always get on with the manager. They don't always get on with each other. So how is that sort of managed in the dressing room where, you know, you're always going to have four legs, but you've got to stick together as a unit, haven't you?
I'd say there's only ever real harmony at a football club when you're playing well and the manager is getting the best out of his players and you're at the top of the league.
Yeah.
And even then, there's still disharmony because the players that want to play are not in the squad.
Mm.
It's no different from any other football club I've been into, any change room I've ever been in, where some players get on, some don't get on. Some don't get on with the manager, some do. So it's no different. But when things like this happen, the toxic atmosphere comes up and you read into it a lot more. And rightly so, but it seems to me now as if the balance has gone the other way, where it's not just a little bit of a problem.
Mm.
There's lots of stuff going
major
on in around the changing rooms, between a divide between the manager and some of his players, between the players and some of the manager, and it's a real difficult one to. But the board are sticking with him.
Absolutely.
That's what they say. So.
Absolutely.
Mm.
Nico Keller's a good question here, Darren. Do you think academy players should be used rather than bringing in players from Europe or elsewhere?
Well, I think you probably know my views on that. I do. I think it's something that traditionally Norwich had always done and brought young players through. I think we've got some real quality coming through at the moment. I think we've seen out on loan boys doing pretty well. Toffolo and Madison, and you've all gone away and done well. Why not stick them in and give them that opportunity? If those senior players are not doing it for the manager, he's well within his rights now to say, look, okay, I've tried to stick with school players, you've had your chance. whatever happens now, either I'm going to go or something's going to happen, or, mm-hmm. or I'm going to show people that I've got a group of the younger lads that can do the job. I do think it's an opportunity for them, yeah. especially now. You know, you think because of the season, it's not over, but you might
nine games to go. Hmm. 11 games to go, 9 points yeah. adrift.
Gives everybody a lift, doesn't it? Getting those young players in.
Yeah, Robin Jacobs Downs asking you, do you see parallels between now and when we're finishing mid-table in the Nationwide League in the 90s?
Yeah, which I was quite part a while ago.
Sore memories?
It is, but I don't think I've ever... Maybe it's because I see it from the outside rather than the inside now, but I think when you're in the inside, you don't see it so much in terms of that toxic atmosphere. I think there's a lot of chat that goes on around the football club, and you're kind of protected when you're inside it a little bit. I think I've never seen it as toxic as this, I feel. But expectations probably back then were different to what they are now, because the team has got into the Premier League.
Yeah.
There is big money. They have had opportunities to spend money and bring people in, yet they haven't done that. And I felt the last time they got out of the Premier League, that was a real opportunity to stay in it for the first time in a long time. And they didn't do that, whereas back in the 90s, we were still rebuilding after a long time.
You mentioned money. Do you think the fact that these guys are earning huge money now, the fans expect them to be doing more, and if they're not, they're going to be criticising more quickly?
It's player power, simple as that. I think we see that from top to bottom. Players call the shots, simple as that. You've got to be one hell of a manager to get a group of players now which want to play for you constantly. They're agent-led, they're player-led. You do have the odd exceptions, and I do believe there is players who play for Norwich that genuinely love playing for Norwich and want the club to do well. But I think, as Johnny Howson said today, you know, people saying that they've let other players down, or Cameron said they let other players down, let the coaching staff down. He's saying, look, I've let myself down. And that's the important part. If you can go to every game and say you gave everything, you've got no one to answer to.
And that's what the fans want, isn't
it? Yeah. If you can see that, then that's not a problem. But at the moment, it appears as if they're just not giving everything. Mm. You know?
Jonathan Parker's asked, do you think Alex Neil would still be in his job at any other club?
No, I don't. I honestly don't. I think
any other championship club would have got rid of him.
I think they would have done. Yeah. And you have to take that as a whole of what the season expectations were at the start, what they then became in terms of the playoffs, and where they are now. Mm-hmm. At the start, we all thought automatic promotion.
Yeah.
I still believe it sounds stupid, but I still believe the squad's as good as probably not quite good as Newcastle's, but certainly up there.
Not a long
probably
way
better
way
than Brighton's, I would say, in terms of the actual real quality. But what they're lacking is that desire and determination. You almost can't buy. You can't see that on stats, and they've bought the wrong type of players.
And do you think too many of them have found it difficult to acclimatise? I mean, I know Close is always pulled out as a player who, you know, clearly got a lot of class, but when it comes to Burton on a Saturday afternoon, you know, it's a bit chilly and he can't play himself out of trouble and tries to do all the tricks rather than just, you know, putting it out of the ground.
I think Close would be good in a good team. And I think when Norwich are playing well, he looks really good, but when the backs are against the wall, I think he struggled a bit. But you look throughout his career, I mean, you look at his stats, I mean, I think he's only ever played maybe one, at most two seasons full way through. Otherwise, he's been injured or out with niggles or stuff like that. So it's no real surprise that the same thing's kind of happening again. But you can almost blame anybody in that squad at the moment. It's just a collective thing as a squad. You go out there, you are individuals, but you collectively go out there as a team. And a team at the moment are kind of, and they know they're letting people down.
Yeah.
But I don't think they're deliberately doing that. I think it's a little bit of mentality that they just don't, you know, they're not strong enough mentally.
Mm. Dan Stacey down said, although City aren't playing well, do you think it's also a case of the quality of opposition in the Championship nowadays is better with maybe 10 or so teams capable of promotion?
No, I don't think the Championship's as strong as it used to be. Mm-hmm. And I will go back to that sort of 90s team, but I don't think the Championship's as strong as it was then. I think if there's any real quality now, and we've seen it from players playing for Brentford, who in Hogan, is it Hogan who was the centre forward?
Scott Hogan
gets bought for £10 million quid, who's never played in the Premier League. Mm. You know, it's done okay, but if you see any real quality now, you're taken as a squad player in the Premier League straight away. So Championship, I don't think it's as strong as it was. I think they're probably fitter, they're more athletic than they were. But in terms of actual ability and quality, I don't think there's as much quality in the Championship, which is what's so disappointing to look at Norwich's squad. Because you look at Norwich's squad, you know, back in the 90s, I could look at most of the squads in that Championship and look at them, pick players out and say, he's a good player. I look outside of Norwich's, Newcastle's, and maybe Brighton's a little bit, and a couple of others. I look down, I don't recognise any of the names, there's nothing that really stands out for me. It's just... That's my own personal opinion. I'm not sure the Championship's as strong as it was.
Yeah. Matty Fitch brings up scouting, which is obviously an issue that's been talked about a lot this season and in previous years. And Matty's saying, well, we're spending millions on players that never get the chance here at Carrow Road. Are they really that bad? If so, what's happening with the scouting system?
We are miles and miles away from having a good scouting system. It's something that probably got hit a little bit the first time they dropped out of the Premier League. It wasn't on the club's radar to do scouting. But also, the academy system. You know, I think it costs around £2 million a year to run that academy, which is Cat 1 registered, which is fantastic. But up until the Murphys, which have only really come in this season, they haven't produced a player in 20 years. So that's 40-odd million quid they've spent on an academy. Let's not produce him. But they've won, in that time, they've won the Youth Cup. Mm-hmm. They've always had decent quality sides. They've never, you know, why have they not brought anybody through that next step? And that's frustrating. But certainly, scouting-wise, it's been terrible.
Where should we be looking for?
Everywhere. It's not difficult. You can find players nowadays, you know. And I still believe lower leagues are a good place to look. I think it's sometimes a little bit snobbery. We don't look down there. We always think that a foreign player who's coming to someone in is going to be better than looking at our own. But I think it's been proven in recent years with some players that have come through those lower leagues before they've got to the Premier League.
Yeah.
Have proved that they're out there. It's just finding them.
And an obvious question on from that, which comes from Jonathan Parker, do you think the £7 million spent on Wilshere would have been better spent on the centre back?
Yeah, I think
straightforward answer, straightforward question.
Well, I think rather than spending £8 million on Pritchard or Naismith, I think that'd been better off. You know,
that's £22 million at those three.
But it's an issue we should have been addressed right at the very start when we were recruiting. We all said it. We all knew the problems were at the back. You know, we still haven't had too much of a problem scoring goals. Mm. It's shipping them the other end, and that's the frustrating thing. We've sort of bought a lot of players that play in similar positions, similar areas of the game, similar kind of mentalities, without really thinking. Not recruiting right, not recruiting correctly, and looking at what we needed, and definitely, I mean, Wilshere to me was a little bit of a panic buy. Mm. You know, for someone to be valued at £7 million, who I think scored 4 goals in 25 games for Wigan.
I haven't seen him do anything yet.
No, but you know, again, like anyway, you need a little bit of time to settle in. I think probably the price tag is he's kind of been a pretty quick rise from Middlesbrough to Wigan for £1 million, and then £7 million to Norwich. I think he's probably feeling the heat a little bit. And it's so difficult for a player to come in and have an impact when there's the atmosphere and the way it is coming to a football club at Norwich at the minute, because he's nervous enough anyway wanting to impress, but when the club's struggling, it's even harder.
Mike Taylor says he's living, he's actually put it in caps about the press conference with Alex Neil. He says the arrogance and accusation that nobody said I was wrong with this group of players at the start of the season. And he says utter, three utters all capped up, rubbish. What do you think about that, Dan?
I think he's I think we've literally just said it, haven't we? I think we looked at the squad and thought there's enough quality in this squad attacking wise, and we've been proved right. You know, even though he likes to play one up front, we're still scoring goals from elsewhere. But I don't know anybody that hasn't said at the start of the season before last, we need some central defenders. We need some defensive quality with a bit of backbone, a bit of steel. I disagree with that. I would say that actually, you know, that group of players, I can see what you're saying, the group of players are good enough, but that needed adding to with a few other players as well. Because clearly, we knew right back then, you've been saying it for years now, that those central backs needed.
Mike's angry. Keep going, Mike.
Go on, Mike, have another one. We're screaming. It is deliberately, specifically sought to oust the two most important players for the Championship, but simply, some of us are insulted to see Alan Neil starting the season with a Bradley Johnson or who's that? Gary O'Neill.
Gary O'Neill. Yeah. Ironically, Gary O'Neill's been dropped, hasn't he, from Bristol City when they always go tomorrow night?
Look, the thing is with this as well, you're always a better player when you're not playing. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember people saying we should put Lafferty in. He deserves his chance. We put him in. He doesn't do anything. So you become a better player when you're not playing.
The song's a good player.
Yeah. But again, someone who's kind of
Gary Docker is a good man, isn't he?
But these players are just stuck around for so long and need refreshing. You look at even in the Championship, you know, there seems to be a constant turnover of players in certain positions, yet we've stuck with that same squad defensively for I don't know how long.
Do you think anybody's really shone this year?
Johnny Howson has done okay. The Murphys have done okay.
Oliveira on the odd occasion?
Yeah, I mean, how do you pick out a player of the season out of that lot? It's been a poor season, and you know, you can only say it's poor by what the aspirations were at the start of the season. And it was automatic promotion, that's what it's all about. We all get back at the first attempt. Then it became, we'll make the playoffs, you know, we'll try and get up for the playoffs, and all of a sudden now it's fallen away from that.
Halfway.
And it's Yeah, you've got Preston on the same points as us.
Yeah.
Preston, who are on the same points as us. It just baffles me.
Mike's still going.
Go on, Mike.
Bradley Johnson. But also, Shazarana, why did you sell Ricky Van Wolfswinkel, Norwich? That's her question.
Well, come on,
Ricky, get him back.
Yeah, I mean, they sold him because he can score goals, simple as that. But I think in his defence, he was playing in a system that was never going to suit him. He was almost playing as a lone striker when he needed to play in a two. He needed to play in a two, playing off someone, 18-yard box player. And I think he would have scored you goals. But again, who recruited him?
Do you think that's the same with Jerome to an extent? He does all that work down the channels. Yeah. And yet, he needs someone there with him.
Yeah, he needs someone alongside him who can score goals.
Yeah.
He can score goals, and he will add to that. But as I say, I don't think the problem's been scoring goals so much. It's been keeping him out the other end. We play so narrow. That's the problem. Mm. Norwich play so narrow. So you've got, you know, as Ipswich did the other week when they came here. You know, although Norwich had all those chances and should have won the game, Ipswich played well, where they just made sure Norwich played really narrow between two 18-yard boxes, giving no room for Hooland.
Combat, isn't it? One question that just came up about the old reserve league. You know, when I grew up, football combination, you've got some decent games.
Yeah.
There's under-23s, there's sort of under-21.
Yep. Shambles.
Do you think a properly organised reserve league where you've got, you know, you've got regular games?
Yeah, and I actually think the FA are realising it now. I'll tell you why, because they've gone under-21s, they've gone under-23s, they've gone overage players in the under-23s. I mean, Norwich's team the other week, the under-23s, I mean, Kyle Lafferty was playing, who's 29.
Yeah.
It's just...
We might get a game down. I must say, Simon Rudd loves us
both. Good. But look, the thing is, right, go back to the old reserve system, you get young kids coming through who learn how to play in men's football, which they don't need to go out on loan then, they learn it there. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember my reserve debut was against Chelsea away, and I played against Steve Clark as right back, and he smashed me in the first 5 minutes, but I knew what level I had to get to. With these under-21s and under-23s, they're kind of playing against their peers every week. It's all a bit nice, all a bit friendly, and they don't
know the jump into the championship or first team football is a huge jump.
It's a huge jump, so they have to go out on loan to lower league clubs to try and get it, and some to sink and some swim. But
Ready saying that we should be the management team.
Well, you know, we're available at a very high price. But it is. But I, the old reserve league was brilliant for that, because you'd also then get the players who are not in the first team playing in it, and if they could then put to cross the manager that they need a game. So someone, if Lafferty was in the reserve scoring goals, he'd be saying, "No, look at me, I'm scoring goals in the reserves. Maybe I deserve a chance."
Really bang on the door.
But a lot of the older players now don't play any games at all.
Yeah.
If you're in the first team squad and you don't play in the under-23s, you don't play. So how can you knock on the manager's door?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. James Kent, good question here. Really talking about rebuilding in the summer, assuming that we've just completely lost this season. Talking about the Murphys, Madison, Godfrey, really building a team around them and getting rid of those players that just aren't doing it.
You've got to be careful. I mean, the Murphys have done okay this season, and Madison hasn't been tested at that level. So it's difficult to say to build a squad around them. I think they should have been given an opportunity in the squad we've got at the moment to see what they can do. To build a squad around such a young team, I think is very difficult.
You'd
need to have some older heads in there, which we've obviously got, but I do agree that there needs to be some kind of clear out in the summer. Mm. But the way you look at it now, I mean, how many do you need to clear out?
Where do you stop?
Five, six, seven?
And I don't really know how easy it is to get rid of players. They're on a decent contract and they're signed up. And nobody comes in for them. Yeah. They don't want to go.
You hear about it as well. I think it was Turner, wasn't it, who had the option for an extra year was his.
Yeah.
And you think, why has a player got an option for another year? Surely that should be down to the manager and the club, shouldn't it, if they want to keep him, not to the player to say, yeah, I fancy him.
And is there any way around that? I mean, if you talk about player power, I know exactly what you mean. Can you get away from that, or do you have to just assume?
No, the game's changed. The game's changed, and that's the way it is now. But that's, again, is why recruitment is so important. Not just to recruit the type of player you buy, but the type of person you buy as well, because you will find them out there. There are ones that want desire and have got that type of desire and energy, determination to play for themselves first of all, to do it right, to play for the football club, to play for the team. They are out there, but at the moment we've been picking all the wrong ones.
We're bringing in the man who knows more than
us. How was the presser?
How was it?
Hello.
Was it quite feisty?
It was very lively.
Was it?
Yeah, Alec is very angry. He's a very angry man.
Well, his anger's aimed at who?
I think
everyone.
I think there's a bit at us. I think.
Okay.
I still haven't got to the bottom of it really. Whether he's angry, it sounded like he's angry at us, and maybe taking bits out of context from Cam's interviews, which I'm not entirely sure. Well, I know didn't happen. He's a bit. Well, he's still very angry at the players. angry at the situation, angry at life. It hasn't gone the way he wanted it to.
He does sound, since Clarke, it does sound to me now like he's almost, this is it, gloves are off. He's basically saying to his players they're not good enough, and he knows which ones they are. He knows which ones he wants out of the football club, and he's letting them know now. He's not deliberately naming them, but he's almost publicly shaming them, which is going to go one or two ways, isn't it? Well, actually, it's only going to go one way, because the players who he knows he's talking about, and they know he's talking about them, they're going to go, right.
It's so hard. I mean, we've got this game on Tuesday. It's all going to be so raw. I mean, it still feels raw to me covering it, so God only knows what it's like for the players and everyone. And what options has he got? You know, he's effectively got to play Cameron. He's not going to start Carl Lafferty tomorrow night, is he? Who's he going to bring? Is it Ryan Bennett and Sebastian Bazong in the middle, or Tim Close and Russell Martin again? There are just so few options for how he would want to change it. Mm. It's hard to. You're either going to get a massive reaction or a massive hangover on Tuesday against a side who are desperate.
Yeah. One win since December.
Yeah. So I'm convinced they'll lose on Tuesday, but you know, you never know.
Yeah, well, I think we all hope what the reaction will be. But even if you get that reaction on Tuesday, and even again at the weekend, something's going to happen again in the future. Well, this exact situation is going to come up again. And how long do you put that for as a football club?
Well, they seem to have entire faith that Alec Neil's the man to turn it around. And even with Cam's quotes and with Russell Martin's quotes after the Brighton game, they were criticising the dressing room. They were effectively criticising the players. So that means it can't be the manager's fault if it's the player's fault. That's
which is fine
the
then.
Logic.
How do you change that in a modern game? How do you change that with the squad? Well, what do you do then?
You get rid of the manager and they can galvanise the dressing room. Yeah. That's what happens.
That's
the
generally,
key to it.
That's
what everyone saying. Does. Look at Leicester.
Yeah. There's no way you can keep the manager and ship out 20 players. Which is basically
what
he's
saying. What they're going to do.
But it just seems bizarre.
Certainly the questions here are all based around
yes.
getting rid of Neil. So
shall I leave you to it?
Your starting point would be getting rid of Neil. Is that the point to start with?
Well, look, it should have been, in my opinion, I think it's been way too long. It should have happened, I think, that after a long period of that poor run, that was a time when, look, I don't care. If Alex Neil might be the best manager in the world, and I still think he's very capable, but if he's those players aren't playing for him, you can't get rid of all the players. You can't. It's not physically possible. So you have to change something else. And generally, as Michael said, the one thing you change is the manager to get that reaction. And that's what gets that group of players back on side again. It might get, you know, Alex Neil's probably gotten back on side for a period of time, but at some point something will happen again. So it's just, it's not been detrimental to Alex Neil saying he's not a very good manager. He's a crap manager. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is, look, those group of players isn't getting, well, he's not getting the best out of that group of players at the moment. And that's just, it will keep coming back. Mm. It will keep coming back unless they can go on a 7, 8, 9, 10 or unbeatable run for the end of the season.
Well, we've had so many swear words over the afternoon. I have to bleep them. We had three
styles in the EDP and Evening News this morning, didn't we?
Are we allowed to swear on Facebook Live, Tom?
Absolutely not.
Oh, okay. No, sorry. Okay.
Lots of people are asking if Darren's got any coaching badges.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have. I've just started them as well, but you know. But the thing is, as well, it's not for me. It's not about coaching badges. It's your knowledge of the game. You have to get your badges to tick boxes, but you know, there's fundamentally the things which I would actually like to be different. But I'm not involved in the football club at the end of the day.
It's not ruling it out. Yeah. I'd write that story.
Absolutely no chance. You know that. You know as well as I do. Once you step foot in Archon.
I did hear Darren that the coach driver has been told to get caught speeding tomorrow night. Oh, yeah. We're going to bring 3 points back to Norwich.
I could be kit man, perhaps.
Question about defensive coach. We've talked about the manager. I don't know if there is a specific defensive coach there.
I'm not sure. I do think a lot more. You look at a lot of clubs now, they are going almost the American football route where you've got specific coaches for specific
So you'd have a goalkeeping coach?
Goalkeeping coach, which they've got.
Defensive coach,
midfield coach, centre forward coach, winger coach, fullback coach, all different people. And even not. They don't even have to be full-time coaches. They can be part-time that come in and work on those areas where people can improve.
So part of the time those groups would be on their own with him?
Yeah.
And then part of the time they'd all be together?
Okay, all together. I think the problem you've got is now as well is that player power is. If they brought someone in to work with those type of players, say if I was to go in and work with the wingers or attacking players, you know, some of them might go, I don't want him in, I don't care what he says. And then again, it's that player power again. But again, that's down to recruitment to make sure you get the right type of players that want to learn and want to get better. Because it doesn't even matter if they picked up one thing off of me that they could help with in their game, it's going to improve them. Bear in mind, anything else, might get nothing out of it. But they pick one thing up and it helps improve their game. It's a bonus.
People saying, when can you start?
Good question from Paul Freeman.
Paul Freeman, yeah. If, and this is a big if with a capital INF from Paul, if Alex Nord be sacked or leave, who do you think, who would you like to see as a new manager? I know it's been asked a lot, but Darren, who's your man?
It's a really difficult one. I mean, someone like, I know Gary Rowett from when I was at Leicester with him.
Still out, is he? Yeah. Still out of work?
Yeah, he's a kind of old school manager in a sense that he'll get his team playing. It will work defensively, first of all. He'll make sure he gets them strong defensively because he was a defender.
Yeah.
So generally, you're trying to find the managers that are going to be defenders that go into management tend to build from the back and do that. So I think he would do that. But look, for me, there's quite a few things wrong at that football club at the minute, unfortunately, and I think just a manager change isn't going to solve all the problems they've got. I think there's problems. I think the board probably needs a little bit of restructuring and updating just to move themselves forward, because it seems to me as if they've been left behind a little bit.
I think Mike's left his caps lock on. He's saying Heckingbottom or Pearson, either of those?
Yeah, I mean, Pearson tends to have an immediate effect, doesn't he? Where he's gone into different football clubs.
Yeah.
Long term, things seem to go a bit pear-shaped for him. Heckingbottom speaks a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. Again, I don't know. It's just, for me, it's irrelevant almost. It's about just getting in a manager that will be a different face for those players.
He might be ready. I'm going to chuck one more in from Ricky Ryan Giggs. He says not much experience, but great connections.
Well, exactly, and also as well, he would get that immediate respect from those players. Mm. They would think Ryan Giggs, what a player that is, you know. And it is that bit of a hangover from Alex Neil, you know, from the first, when he first started, people were kind of questioning, you know, who is he? He's young manager who's don't really know about. And unfortunately, a lot of players might have looked at that and thought, I'm not sure. I mean,
clearly there is something about Alex Neil. Do you think he could go somewhere else and do better, or do you think? Maybe it's a combination of him here and.
I think he's learning a lot and having to learn quickly now. I think there's, but it's always easy to say from the sideline when things are going wrong that he's doing stuff wrong. But I think selections have been wrong at times. I think substitutions have been a bit wrong, and he's very rigid in the way he likes to set his teams up. I've quite liked seeing managers even change their system during the game to try and get themselves back into it. Whereas Alex doesn't tend to do that, but that's his style. Mm. You know, he's sticking by that, and that's what he hopes eventually will make him into the manager that he wants to become.
James Ellis has turned the attention away from Alex Neil to the board. He's something they've got a lot to answer for. Do you think they've got a part to play as well?
Of course they have. They employ the manager. Mm-hmm. They hire and fire.
But in terms of them going, do you think there's any?
I don't think it's going to happen. I think they've clearly said that Dealey and Michael do not want to sell the football club. I think it'll be handed down to their nephew, who I've met two or three occasions. I think he's very good and run the club well. I think the financial chap is really good as well. Steve Stone. I've met him a few times, really like him. Not sure we need a CEO.
That's a question actually from James Kent.
Yeah.
He said, should we appoint him? Is that an issue?
It depends what you. I mean, if the CEO is there to. For me, without being too derogatory, I'm not sure Ed Balls has really added anything to the football club at all in terms of his persona and who he is. Of course, it's drawn attention to the football club, but structurally running the football club, I don't think he's helped a great deal. A CEO, if it's the right one, they're great. If they're not, I mean, it's cost us a lot of money over the last few years to have a CEO. But I do think we are stuck in a bit of the dark ages of the football club. And as much as we love to have that traditional kind of flowery view of this is how we want to do it, and it is done differently here, I'd admit that. I think things can work differently here in Norfolk, and this football club can be different to all the others. But it's been such the same so long that it just feels like it needs freshening up.
Yeah. I think Michael Allen's got his tongue in his cheek a little bit here. He wants to know which one of the Sheffield Wednesday goals did you enjoy most, Darren? And his favourite was the first one, a lovely pass, he said. It was, wasn't it? Down in the corner, past to Wallace.
It was a great, great ball, it's just, the disappointing thing, as I said, they didn't have to work hard for any five of their goals, did they, really? It was
three headers.
And again, what do we go back to again, about talking about recruitment-wise, defensively, if you can't put a challenge on a header in a championship, you're going to struggle. And we saw it three times in one game. So it's clear where the issues
It wasn't complicated football they played, did it?
No.
I mean, the free kick from Forestier was a great strike. Yeah.
But even you go back to the Ipswich game, look at the goal that scored there. Dykes didn't get close enough to the person crossing the ball. Murphy let him run off him. Simple head into the bottom corner. Yeah. It's not rocket science. It's really not. But the only difference is just that little bit of desire from those individuals to make sure that they close that cross down, to make sure they track their man when it's running.
Yeah.
When they're running. But that is a lot more difficult when things aren't going well. Players will hide a little bit more. It's easy, the easiest game in the world when you think you're confident and you're playing well because you can do anything you like. But when things are struggling, that's when you see the real characters in the side and they tend to just drop their performance a little bit or hide just a little bit and not want the ball. And that makes a massive difference.
Yeah. Andy Newton's asking about director of football. One of those roles that some clubs have, some don't.
I think it needs something. I think it needs some guidance on the football side. Clearly, for too long, recruitment's been poor.
Mm-hmm.
The academy has not produced anything apart from the two Murphys that have now come through. So certainly, there certainly needs to be someone to oversee the football side. I mean that has been evident for how many years now? Have we talked about recruitment and the youth team? But we've got away with it because they've got into the Premier League a couple of times. But you can't stand still. Once you're there, you've got to try and keep building to make sure that there's progression from that. Was I think we got there, kind of relaxed a little bit, thought, I know what we'll do, we'll go and buy a few foreign players that we think are brilliant, and we find ourselves where we are now.
Lots of talk about youth, and I think you probably covered that down when you said it can't just be chuck all the kids in, and it can't be keep all the kids out.
No.
You think it's some experience, some new lads, some young kids.
There was opportunities this season when Norwich have played well to have a couple of youngsters on the bench. Then you've got the opportunity then when you are beating Brentford 5-1 whatever it was, or you're beating Forest 5-0, put them on for 10-15 minutes just to give them that experience. But for me, it hasn't been done enough, and you know, that's where you gain your experience and you're out on loan, but actually being part of that first team squad on the day is so important to get you involved even on the bench, just to learn from those other players what they do, how they prepare. Yeah, and there's no reason why they shouldn't be involved now.
Benny Benifer, they should be made to watch the academy boys at Plan Sunday to show them what passion and heart is. What about that? Players going actually, rather than, you know, the kids watching the first teamers the other way around.
Well, I'll tell you what, I mean, there's a lot to be said for that. I know John Terry was a big fan of going to watch the youth team and watching the under-23s and under-21s play and going to see those kids and putting their arm around them and trying to give them advice and help them through. But then he loved playing for Chelsea and he wanted to be there, and Chelsea a brilliant side, so he cares about that football club, and perhaps that's something that's just lacked here a little bit. There's too many players here at the moment that
and we hear some stories, don't we, about players that are injured or aren't playing in the team, they're actually elsewhere watching other games. I mean, do you think that if you're not playing you should be...
I was shocked when I heard Oliveira was at the EFL final rather than at the derby.
Do you think that if you're injured or you're not playing, you should be there watching the team, supporting them?
Yeah, we always were. We always were.
I think, you know, fans always...
And I can't believe Alex Neil was giving him the permission to go and do it. So he must have done it off his own back, I would think, because, you know, it should be there for every game. In fact, it's a derby. You should even more reason for you to be there.
Yeah. More about Cameron Jerome. So do you think that the comments he made, other players will feel empowered now to come out and say more, or will they feel more reluctant after a game?
It depends on the individuals, I think. Some will like to say stuff, some will keep quite quiet.
It's about characters. I really can't read that.
It's about characters, individual characters. Some will come out and say something, but I think the fact that Cameron Jerome has come out and said something was a...
Not the most obvious to be outspoken.
No, and probably more because he said something that shows the more of the problem there is, because for him to speak up and say something, it shows he cares, but also the damage that has been
done. So he spoke on Saturday night, didn't he? So after that game in Sheffield, would the players better travel back together, would they?
Yeah, they should have done. I mean, if they'd got permission from the manager to stay up and say something and look north and they wanted to stay up and see the families, they should all be travelling back together.
Yeah.
I'd imagine
that. Maybe on a coach or...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they look, players... It would have been, but players, even if you don't get on, players would get on in a sense. You know, you're still teammates and you go out there and play, but it doesn't mean you're going to go and have dinner with them or anything like that. I can imagine that was a pretty long journey.
Yeah, the A17 would have been even longer than normal. James Kidd, straightforward question here, Darren, which players will he drop tomorrow?
Who can he drop? I mean, he's got a few injuries at the minute, so he's struggling in that sense. Does he...
Is he changing at the back?
Does he...
Bessong back?
there's your options, isn't it? I mean,
Michael Turner, is he still around?
What kind of options have you got? And that's it at the moment. You look and you say, what have we gone straight back to again where the problems are?
So it would be desperation rather than saying, there's a lad who hasn't been playing, he's going to do a better job. You think it would be actually, I've just got to do something.
Got to make a change or something. But I think he'll start with the same group of players and say, look, whatever happened last week, you've got to go out there and prove yourselves now that actually you do care.
Mm. Interesting one from Simon Wilkinson. He's saying, I didn't actually hear this interview, but he said Martin Olsen said after his first training session, he'd never been worked so hard.
He was aching for days.
So, does that say something about Swansea? Does it say something about Norwich? Somewhere in the middle?
My own personal opinion is they haven't been fit enough all season. I know Alex Neil's come out this morning and said that's a nonsense, and he feels that they're as fit as they've been, or as fit as they've been all season, or the fittest group he's ever had, or whatever he said. I remember early on in the season seeing them running around the pitch with gel packs with 20 minutes to go, getting on extra energy, and even if that is helping. To me, it's just a sign to the opposition to say they're struggling a bit. You shouldn't need it. Get through 90 minutes of football.
And it's, we hear a lot about the workload of players and the game, Tuesday, Saturday, Tuesday. But is it any different?
No. No, the pitches are much better now. They've not got big, heavy pitches. I think the pace of the game might change just slightly, but you should be able to get through 90 minutes. I just think they've struggled. But also, again, the manager and the players' defence, you become more tired when things are struggling. Things seem a lot harder than they do when you're, we can see when they were beating Forest 5-0 and Brentford, they look like they could carry on for another two games.
Yeah.
But when things are struggling, that's when you look like your fitness levels aren't good enough.
Tony Bradfield saying a few players at Hockering FC would show a commitment and give a good run out. And that is a rough pick. James Kent, thanks for another question, James. What about Ben Godfrey at the back? He says that's his best position.
Yeah.
Bring him in for us. Says James Kent.
Well, I think there's an opportunity now for Alex Neil to. He's basically come out and said his players let him down away from home, and they've not got the attitude, the desire, or the determination. I think the words are used. Then make that change. If you don't think they can do that, then you've got to stick someone else in.
Yeah.
Why not? Why not give Godfrey the opportunity? He came in for a bit and did all right. So, what you got to lose?
And tomorrow night, Bristol City. As you said earlier, they've won one in. Have many games since December. Do you go for it tomorrow night?
Of course you do. You've got no other opportunity, have you?
Do you think Neil will think, I can't possibly lose? Almost, I'll be cautious.
He's got to go for it.
Is that going to be in his mind now to be cautious so they don't get whipped again?
I think he's gone past that. I think it really is. It really is now or never for him. I think he wants a reaction from his players to win 2 or 3, 4, 5, all the games left are all now in the end of the season. I think he's made his point about his players, and we'll see.
Chance for any final questions? One about where your curls have gone down, which you can answer while we're waiting for any more.
It's when my hair gets wet. The old 90s curly curtains. It does come back, it's wet. But no, I'll try to.
Looking good, though. Assuming that it's clearly gone for Norwich, who do you think are going to be the top two and who are going to be the four in the playoffs?
I think Fulham might sneak in. I think they're
in the playoffs.
Do at the moment. I would still like to hope we can, but that is just more optimism than belief. I think perhaps it is, but they've got some work to do, Norwich, but at the moment. The top two look pretty secure. The other four, as I say, it's so disappointing because I still think, ability wise, or pure ability, our squads are better than any of those. Mm. But you've got to have more than just the ability.
Yeah. Gary Sarraz asking about Nathan Redmond. Mm. Two more goals yesterday. I know clearly he's playing in a really good side, but he looks a really good player, doesn't he?
Yeah,
what do you think they're doing there at Southampton that he wasn't happening with him here?
I think he's got a bit more freedom.
Mm-hmm.
I think he was...
Or to almost play where he wants?
Not as much play where he wants, but I think he was asked, as the Murphys are asked, to make sure that defensively they're right as well. And you do need that. But I think the way Alex Neil sets his teams up needs that even more. Mm-hmm. Whereas a different system would perhaps free them up to actually not have to work so hard defensively. But when you play the system that Alex Neil likes to play with one up front, you've got to have defensive responsibilities and... You can get caught out if you haven't got them. Naturally, those boys, I just don't think I've got them. They've got a bit of it, but they're never going to be defenders. Mm-hmm. And they will get caught out. So, it's difficult.
Mark Taylor, thanks again. Mark, he's actually gone back to normal font now. The caps have gone. Talk about the flawed tactics, particularly in the midfield. Shifting the ball quickly. We talked about defence, we talked about attack. Do you think there's an issue in the middle of the park as well?
I do think we play laboured, yeah.
You said about playing narrow.
Yeah, they play really narrow. I think we need to play with more width. I think we need to play with more pace and intent. We have done it this season. They've blown teams away. But
The derby was too patient, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. When, sometimes you've got to go long just to stretch the back four. By pushing them back, we'll then give all that space in the midfield areas for the other ones to work in, or if that's not working.
And we have got pace, haven't we?
When Dykes get out wide a couple of times and got some decent balls in, why did they not try and get a bit more width to it? I think because we are good at keeping the ball on occasions, I think we just think it's going to happen and we have to score that perfect goal. Whereas I think you see good teams at the minute, it's about playing quick and with pace in the Championship, and you can blow teams away. Newcastle do that.
And if you're one of those defenders from not such a good side, you're going to be scared out of your mind. Yeah. If you've got lads going down the wings, and you've got ball going over.
And we've got those type of players.
Yeah.
Yet we don't seem to play them to their strength.
You know, we look at the other team and say, well, they're going to be strong, so we need to be patient in the build rather than say more stuff to you. We're going to play our game.
Yeah, exactly.
Last one.
Eadie for manager.
That's not going to happen, is it?
No. And just nerves or bounce back, do you think they're going to be really nervous tomorrow, or will we see that real reaction?
Again, it'll be down to the individuals. I think some will be absolutely pooping it.
Yeah.
And some will be confident and not bother them, go out there and trying to prove people wrong. I hope most of the majority of them are like that, but like we've said all season, I'm not sure what we're going to get Clarkie tomorrow night. Fingers crossed we get a decent result, and all of a sudden then things might just turn around a bit. But at the moment it's looking pretty desperate.
Darren, thanks for your honesty as always. You've made lots of new fans on there. Thanks for all your questions. That's a really great mix, and it shows how much the fans care. We know that, don't we?
Absolutely.
We care passionately. They've all got their own views. So keep a good eye on our website. So there's going to be loads of stuff going on, obviously, after the very lively press conference. And we'll be back soon with lots more questions and lots more answers.
Yeah, thanks for joining us. And make sure you come back, because we will be doing this on a regular occasion. And like Mike, you can vent your anger if you wish.
Keep that caps lock on.
We'll happily fend off your questions. Thanks for joining us. See you later.